All right, continuing on with section 8.3, working with confidence intervals for means. Example, the U.S. Department of Energy surveys households to obtain data on monthly fuel expenditures for household vehicles. A random sample of 27 household vehicles yields a mean of $158.90 and a standard deviation of 27. Before we get started on any of the rest of the problem, I'm just going to label some of this information. The sample size is given right here, 27, so that's my N. And then the sample produced this mean and standard deviation, so this is a sample mean and a sample standard deviation. So sample means are X bars and sample standard deviations are S's. And just the fact that they're giving us a mean and a standard deviation makes me think that this problem is about averages rather than proportions, and that's always an important part to get straight right off the bat. All right, so now let's go ahead and start looking at this. Comment on the requirements. Well, when you're dealing with problems about averages, you need X bar to be normally distributed. And that would happen if they told us that the population was normal or if they gave us a large sample size. But in this case, our sample size of 27 is just medium size. So I'm going to start off by stating that since 15 is less than or equal to N is less than 30, or in other words, because I have a medium-sized sample size, then I need a population that is not severely skewed. And I don't know if I have that or not, so I'm going to say that I must hope that the population is not severely skewed. And I need that so that X bar will be normally distributed and the requirements will be met. So in this case, I don't really know if the requirements are met or not because my sample size means I need a population that's not severely skewed, and I'm not sure what type of population I have, so I'm left hoping that it's not severely skewed so that X bar will be normal. Just worth a quick mention, if they had given us the data, then we would have also had the option here of maybe making a box plot and taking a look at the graph of that box plot to see if it indicated a population that was severely skewed. So, for example, if that box plot had a stubby whisker on one side and a long whisker with outliers on the other, then I might consider that a violation of what I need here. But if the box plot is even roughly symmetric or even skewed but just a little bit, then I tend to think that I was okay. All right, let's go ahead and move on with the math. They want us to determine a 95% confidence interval for the mean monthly fuel expenditure of all households. So it's a confidence interval, but it's always important to note what kind. It's a confidence interval for the mean. For a confidence interval for the mean, my formula is going to be X bar plus or minus T star times S over the square root of N. So that's the formula that I'm going to want to use. And we've already noted up here that they gave us the values of X bar, S, and N. So the one thing we don't have is T star. So I'm going to go ahead and start working on that by drawing a picture of a bell-shaped curve. This would be the T-curve. And whenever you're doing a T-curve, you need to think about the DF. The DF is N minus 1, so if N is 27, then the DF would be 26. So that's coming from doing 27 minus 1. And then they want us to be 95% confident, so I would show that as the area in the middle. If there's 95% in the middle, that leaves 5% left over. I would split that 5.5% into two parts, which would be 2.5% on each side. And then we could use inverse t to try and find this, but the other option that we've seen is that we can use that table from our formula sheet. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. T star would be this boundary right here, and it would be a t score that has an area of 0.025 to its right on a t curve where the df is 26. So if I bring in that table, I'm looking for a t-score with 0.025 to its right and with 26 degrees of freedom. So that 26 degrees of freedom shows up right there in the t.025 row. So it looks like my t-score would be 2.056 on this one. I'll fill that in, 2.056. And now we have everything that we need to go ahead and use our formula. So I'll just kind of summarize it all here. We have our t-score, and then we saw up above that our x-bar was 158.90. And we saw that the s was 42.75. And we know that our sample size was 27. So taking all those pieces, we can start plugging into the formula. We'll start off with that 158.90. That's the value from the sample. Basically no chance that that's right, so we're going to give ourselves some room for error by adding and subtracting 2.056 standard deviations of x bar. And our best guess at that would be using s over root n. So we put in the s, 4275, and divide that by the square root of 27. And as I mentioned before, it's always nice to see that plus or minus piece because that indicates how much we think we might have missed by. So we want to show that in the next step. So I'll bring the 158.90 down and then go ahead and calculate that plus or minus piece. So let's bring in the calculator. So we have 2.056 times 42.75 divided by the square root of 27. Whoops, divided by the square root of 27. So that is t star times s over root n. And we're always going to match decimals with that, with our original point estimate. So this had two decimal places, so we'll do that here too. So 16.92 is what I'm going to put. And then the last step is to turn that into an interval. I said bring that calculator right back in. So we have the 158.90 minus 16.92, and then second enter, and change that to a plus, and we get our two boundaries. So the left side is 141.98, and the right side is 175.82. And then what was it we were finding a confidence interval for in the first place? It was for the mean monthly fuel expenditures of all household vehicles. So the mean of all would be the population mean, or mu. So I'm 95% confident that the mean monthly fuel expenditures of all household vehicles somewhere between $141.98 and $175.82. So can I say, based on that interval, that we are 95% confident that the mean monthly fuel expenditure for all households is greater than $150? So I would have to look at this and say, let's see, is the entire range a yes? Is the entire range greater than 150? And it's not. And I mentioned earlier that in order to say yes, the entire range has to be yes. So if some part of that is under 150, then I'm going to have to say no. And my explanation would be, if mu is an element of that interval from 141.98 to 175.82, the problem with that and being able to say yes to this question is anything in here is a reasonable possibility for mu, and that implies that mu could be a number like, let's say, $146.13, which is in this interval, but it's not greater than 150. And that basically takes care of it. So if there's any value in the interval that's a no, that makes it a no to this question. And when you're asked to explain, you should just pick a value that's an example of that. Something in the interval, and therefore a reasonable possibility for what mu could be, one of the values in our confidence range, and yet is a value that we can't say yes to that question for. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at one final example from section 8.3. A large company is interested in the true average length of telephone calls made by its employees. They randomly select 837 calls, and they find the mean duration to be 3.872 minutes with a standard deviation of 4.0539 minutes. Comment on the requirements for finding a confidence interval for the mean duration of all the calls. So notice that it's a confidence interval for the mean. For confidence intervals for the mean, we need either a large sample or a population that's normal. Here it says they randomly select 837 calls. I believe that would be my sample size. So I have an N of 837, which is well over 30. So I'm going to use that as my reason here. And I'm going to say, because N is equal to 837, which is greater than or equal to 30, that implies that X bar is normally distributed, or at least approximately normally distributed. And that's what we need for doing confidence intervals for the mean, so that implies that the requirements are met. This is the easiest and actually one of the most common discussions that we would have about the requirements for doing a confidence interval for the mean. If our sample size is over 30, X bar is normal and the requirements are met, and it's fairly common to have a sample size of 30 or more. You notice in this case they've got a sample size well over 30. All right, so let's go ahead and obtain a 95% confidence interval for the true mean duration of all the calls made by the company's employees. So this is about the mean. So when we're doing confidence intervals for the mean, we want to do X bar plus or minus a T star times S over root N. And if we go back and look at the top of this question, we'll see that they gave us the X bar and the S. It says they randomly selected 837 calls, so I would take that to be their random sample. And the mean from that sample is 8.72, or 3.872. That's the mean from a sample, so that's X bar. I'll go ahead and list that down here too. So X bar is 3.872. And then the standard deviation also from that sample is 4.0539, so that would be S. And then we already noted that N was equal to 837. So we have almost every piece that we need to start using that formula. The one that's missing is the T star. So I'll go ahead and draw in a bell-shaped curve. Should be my T distribution. With the T distribution, we're always concerned about the DF. The DF is 1 less than the sample size, so 837 minus 1 would be 836. And then they want us to be 99% confident, so that's the area that I would show in the middle. And that leaves 1% left over, but I have to divide that 1% among the two sides, so each side would have 0.005. So now this value right here would be the T star that we need, and we can find that by looking on our table. We want to look for the T score that has area 0.005 in the tail with 836 degrees of freedom. So we go to our table, we look at the T of 0.005 column, and what we want to do is drop down until we find a degree of freedom of 836. But you'll see here we only have degrees of freedom of 500 or 1,000. So we're going to have to go with one of these two values, but we need to think about which one real quick. And here's the idea. The right answer is actually somewhere in between, so if we go with one of these, we're going to make a little bit of a mistake. If we go with 2.586, we'll use a number that's too big and our interval will be too wide. If we go with 2.581, that'll create an interval that's a little bit narrower. So if we're going to have a mistake, would we rather have an interval too wide or too narrow? And the answer is too wide, because if you have an interval that's wider than you need, you'll be right more often than you thought you would be. If you have an interval that's narrower than you need, then you'll be wrong more often than you thought you would be. So what we're going to do when we land in between the 500 and the 1,000 is we're going to use the lower one. So we're going to use a DF of 500. If you don't like this situation, you could actually go back and use the inverse T from the calculator. But we're going to go with this situation, go ahead and use the table. So I'm going to use the 500, which would be the 2.586. And I'm going to say that's my value of T star. So now we have all the pieces that we need. We have our X bar, our S, our N, and now our T score. So let me go ahead and start plugging into the formula. So our X bar is 3.872. We want to add and subtract 2.586 standard deviations, or in this case student deviations of X bar, because we're going to use S over root N. So 4.0539. And divided by the square root of N, which is 837. And we always want to see that plus or minus piece, so I'm going to calculate this part right here and show that as I move over to the next step. So I'd still have the 3.872, but I want to figure out what is the plus or minus piece. So that would be 2.586 times, and then what do we have there? 4.0539 divided by the square root of 837. Square root of 837. So T star times S over root N. We want to match decimals, 1, 2, 3, so we want to do the same thing on our plus or minus piece, so that would be plus or minus 0.362. And then from there we can go to our answer. We'll do the subtraction, 3.872 minus 0.362, and then we'll do the addition. And we get these two boundaries. Notice one of them has two decimals and the other has three. That's because these two twos at the end canceled off when we subtract. Not only do we want to match three decimals here and three decimals here, but we want that to show up in our interval as well, regardless of what digits we see on our calculator. So if you end up with a shorter number, that just means that next one was a zero, and you should write that to show the consistency in your interval. And then this was an interval for the true mean duration, so the true mean is a reference to the population mean, which would be mu. So there's my confidence interval. So the kind of wrinkle that showed up in this one is, what do we do if the DF that we're using doesn't show up on our chart? And the answer is, use the smaller DF from the chart. And again, the other option, which is actually even more accurate, would be to use inverse t of 0.005 and find the negative value and then switch it to the positive. And when you do that on the calculator, you could use the DF of 836. Just remember, that's not a possibility on the TI-83, only on the TI-84. All right, let's interpret our interval in words. I think it would be a good opportunity here for you. This is not a fill-in-the-blank one. This might be a nice one for you to pause the video and see if you can write out that interpretation on your own. So go ahead and pause, and then when you're ready to check your answer, go ahead and hit play again. All right, so here's my answer to that. I am 99% confident that the true mean duration of all the calls made by the company's employees is somewhere between 3.510 minutes and 4.234 minutes. Let me write that out. All right, let me go ahead and just read through that and point out some of the key details. So I'm 99% confident that the true mean duration of all the calls made by the company's employees is somewhere between 3.510 minutes and 4.234 minutes. And then just some things that we want to make sure of. We want to always make sure we're referencing the mean and that it's the mean of the population. So here you see that I'm talking about the mean. When I say it's the true mean, that is a reference to the population. I'm even being a little redundant here and saying it's the true mean of all calls. Either the word true or the word all, either one of those would say this is a population mean, not just a sample mean. And then I want to always make it clear that I don't actually know exactly what the answer is, so this word here gets that idea across, that it's somewhere between 3.510 minutes and 4.234 minutes, and it's also good to make sure you always get units on your answer as well. All right, one final question there. How close do you think that X bar is to mu? So this goes back to that idea that I have no faith that this is the right answer for the population. This is just for my sample, and it has almost no chance of being equal to the population mean. But when I add and subtract 0.362 minutes, now all of a sudden I'm 99% confident that I'm in this interval. So I must feel that I'm 99% confident that even though this answer is wrong, that it's within 0.362 of the right answer. So I would reference that plus or minus piece as my answer here and say I think that I am within 0.362. And then again, there should be units on this. This is the length of those phone calls, which was measured in minutes. So you'll see this in the next page, in the next section, but that would be then our margin of error. So the plus or minus piece is always a margin of error on a confidence interval. All right, that wraps it up for section 8.3.